Very happy to introduce you the last speaker of the day. Not because he's the last speaker of the day, but because he's Susan Paulson, who has been introduced to this morning actually already by some stories, so I don't need to do that. But I would just like to add to the introduction that Susan was with us for a couple of years, not so long ago, as a guest professor, and we immediately remember what kind of inspiration and positive energy she brought to the department. We badly miss that. The good news is that Susan put some popping up here, and this is one of those occasions to get to talk to that wonderful title, Pieces of the Problem of Climate Change.
So a couple of years ago when I was here at Lund, I was part of an interdisciplinary team looking at soot, black carbon. There was a combustion engineer looking at engines and filters, geologists looking at what happens when the soot settles on glaciers and ice fields, aerosol physicists looking at how the particulate emission interacts in the atmosphere with other elements. We had soot mixed with clouds, environmental health people, remind me whenever, looking at how the impacts are different in different places. And we're, of course, particularly interested in the uneven geographies of production and consumption and profit from this soot production. And one of the fascinating things we noticed was just in the decade when Europeans were becoming more green and fulfilling the Kyoto commitment by switching to biofuels, something interesting happened in the Amazon. More soot every year, just peaking at the period of cane burning. Cane is one of, some of you are smiling, of course, yeah, one of the big feedstocks for biofuels. So airborne tests showed this increase at the same time the Amazon, who had been experiencing for some time a decrease in the rate of deforestation, had a bad turn and went back to greater deforestation. So everything was connected in quite complex ways. And I started looking at this question in relation to other stuff going on in South America at the time. Anyone of you, raise your hand if your work has something to do with any of these innocent activities. You look at them, you invest in them, study them, look at them all. Very good. All right. Yeah, in the peanut gallery there. Yes. Yeah. What do they have in common?
Climate change.
They all contribute to climate change. What else? Someone said destruction, degradation. Right. Immediate degradation of the environment right around where it's happening. Big climate change. What else?
Money?
All those things. I became interested in a fascinating phenomenon. All of these activities in Latin America, where I've seen them, depend on the production and consumption of a certain type of human. People seen anyone like that around? The visa burden? This is Serra Pelada, a giant mine in Brazil. In the 80s and into the 90s, they were hiring 100,000 men worked at any given moment there. Cane cutting, they do businesses, charcoal making, forestry. Yeah, everyone's familiar with this scene, right? So my question is, what kind of policy environment or world market environment allows for a scene of extremely asymmetrical exchange in access to natural resources and in access to these human resources? One of the things we know about is enormous inequality. This is by regions. The same thing has happened over the recent decades in terms between countries and between groups within countries. Enormous inequality. I'm also asking, what kind of cultural system is necessary or is working out to produce these beasts of burden, right? Places, people, processes that are shaping what we see there. All right, so when I've been asking and exploring what makes relations between place and people more sustainable, more humane, less, one idea I've been thinking about is territory. I know some of you in here also work in the territory. Andrea did a beautiful thesis at Lund University about it. An idea of a social natural space that is constantly being produced and reproduced by relationships of power operating on different levels. And amongst those relationships, I'm especially interested in the ones that are shaped by class, by racial, gender, spatial differences. Asymmetric. All right, so a few years ago, I got a chance to think about these issues on a much more systemic level with a giant research project in Latin America. It brought together 50 organizations, 150 researchers, doing a project that was comparative, 20 different territories selected in Latin America, that used both sort of comparative time period data, logistical data, longitudinal data, and also interdisciplinary field studies in these 20 territories. So I'm going to actually use some of both of those kinds of findings. I was involved in 5 of these studies. So before I present a case that came from there, I think it's important I work on putting these cases in national, regional, international scale processes to see how they're working with each other. So I'm going to start out looking at a few processes that show how identity is shaping and being shaped by uneven geographies in Latin America, and then I'll put the case within those geographies. All right, one thing that's happening is some very interesting gender changes. Most of you probably have heard about this in the past. The period of study is 25 years, right? We have time series data over 25 years, and our case study happened in the last 5 years. All right, during that period, women, much higher educational attainment, employment, life expectancy, lower fertility, some improvements in politics, not much change in domestic labor. Who here pretty much knew, if not Latin America, in other parts of the world, that these things have been happening for that sort of group in the past 25 years? Raise your hand. You're pretty familiar if you've been hearing about that. Okay. We're not going to see so much. I just wanted to give a few examples of how uneven the geographies are. Yeah. How uneven the geographies are. All right. One thing that's happening in every Latin American country, except for one, I believe, is a feminization of urban populations and masculinization of the countryside. So we've got this kind of strange polarization where women are either moving to cities or staying there, and rural places are inhabited more by men. Another uneven thing that's happening is political representation, where in Latin America, the red bar is the elected council members that many of them have been impacted by quotas over the past 25 years, and the number of women has increased significantly to 25%. At the same time, you see the mayors, which we call uninominales, right? There's just one person, they don't have a quota list, and it's changed from 5.5% to 6% over that period. And so we've got this kind of political intransigence that is especially important in the countryside. Just to show you that things are quite uneven in terms of spatial organization and power in terms of gender. Also, an amazing change has happened in terms of employment. The World Bank estimates that 70 million women added to the workplace during this time period. All kinds of discussions about who that was good for, or what were the impact. There's no doubt that it was good for national GDPs, probably good for a lot of corporations, agribusinesses. What impact it made on families, on women, on community, that's something we can discuss later if you wish. I think this is one of the, well, I won't get into it because we got to get to our case study. All right. Now I'd like to take a few minutes to look at some changes for men. If women's experience has been mixed in this period, I would say men, in almost all the indices that I know where men do worse than women, it's gotten more worse over this period. One of them is education, where actually every year more women are in college than men and in high school. There's still almost parity in elementary school. And the fascinating thing is, this is true across all the economic sectors. Gender and economy intersect at every turn, socioeconomic class. And it's interesting that more girls than boys, more young women than men are in high school and college across the board. A lot of talk has been happening about the impact of structural reforms, flexibilization of the workforce, etc., on breadwinners. It's been pretty hard for people that needed to have the income and the insurance for their family, and they could no longer get them because their labor became less secure. But another thing that I think is very important is that this shift has really influenced a 20th century tradition where for many men in Latin America, their identity was connected to the workplace. These statements, everyone can sort of read these, they're not about what you do. These are ontological statements. It's not like, oh, I hope, I am a farmer, I am a miner. And beyond that, people found political power and social identity in work. Unions, very strong in many of these and other professions. You see here some truckers' unions. That's where people found esteem, prestige, location, public civic participation in parades, and political power, political participation in the unions. So as less and less workplaces are offering this type of identity, this type of political power to men especially, because they were the ones that had been involved in this, many men are looking for other ways to experience power. One of them seems to be refusing to do women's work. Right? That's one of the ways of identifying their masculinity. Now, time use studies all over Latin America find that, of course, women and girls do most of the work. The interesting thing is how little it's been changing. 70 million women go into the workplace, and their children don't seem to be organizing the labor much different than the previous generations. And these three charts are fascinating. They show what people's, this is a young group, 15 to 19 year old, what's your first activity most important? More girls than boys, it's studying. More boys than girls, it's working for money. These are teenagers, right? So we already see maybe some difficulties, prejudices for men coming up in that moment where they're expected to earn money. Another thing that's interesting is that boys and girls are dedicating their time to studying and working and earning money. But there's one category where there's a categorical exclusion of one group. What is that? In fact, it's not easy to even try to break that rule, because if any of you have tried it, you know what happens. All right, so you may laugh. Okay, some of you may say, well, oh great, it's a great benefit to men, an advantage to be excluded from domestic work, because then they can do manly stuff like earning money and whatever. But what I'm seeing is that more and more men who are unable or unwilling to participate in the basic labor of sustaining a household, health, food, etc., are actually being excluded from households. And now we've got over one third of the households in Latin America are what's called single mother households by the census thing, and more divorce and more separation. So we've got this huge millions and millions of men who are no longer sort of, or aren't, at the moment, part of this, which is one of the places where the beasts of burden are found, right? Amongst that kind of group of men that aren't participating in the family thing. Now, it could be that I'm pretty concerned about this. I think it's a challenge for sustainability on many levels. on the social level, because to survive, the main thing for all human groups is to reproduce our labor every day by food, by warmth, by affection, and also to reproduce our generations by bearing children, raising children. And so that needs to be worked out for sustainability. It also seems to be a problem for environmental sustainability. If these shifts produce a whole group of humans who are then available to work in these machines of logging, of mining, of whatever, because those humans are necessary to make the machines work. The funny thing is, I want people to be upset about this. I want governments to be upset about that. But they seem to be actually helping, not only our friends at the bar, but publicity, media, and governments are actually helping. I don't have the law here. And here is, there's numerous laws all over that discriminate against men. In Chile, labor law number 18620 says, every business that employs more than 20 women of any age or marital status should have a daycare center attached to the workplace. There's no, you know about this. Right. You know, there's no protection of the right of responsible parenthood, etc. Right? Okay, another thing I'm concerned about is life expectancy. In general, it's increased in Latin America, but the destruction of human capital has gotten more and greater inequality disfavoring men. Every country in the region shows disproportionately high rates of men as victims of occupational accidents in all of those places that you saw, especially mining, logging, commercial fishing, etc. Also, traffic accidents, alcoholism, homicide, and suicide. You won't believe these are amazing. The purple is the life expectancy of women and the green of men. And again, if you look, these countries are organized sort of by where they are in the demographic transition. And even the ones that are like Haiti, Bolivia, on one end of the demographic transition, Chile, more advanced. In all the cases, women are far outliving men. That's something new. Here, I'll just jump to this one. You can see in this chart, this is a world on the top, right? The world population. Through the 1900s, men and women had the same life expectancy. Something happened in the 20th century to make men die sooner or women live longer. And that's a very complicated thing that's going on. But one of the things is here. This is the Health in the Americas by the World Health Organization. They found that on average, 10 men are killed for every woman in murdered, right? That's a really interesting violence. And I'm even more intrigued or upset when I find out the sort of class intersection of that. Half the men, half the humans murdered are in the least educated quintile of the adult male population. What do we know about that quintile? I think that's where the beasts of burden are coming from, isn't it? What do you think? They're disposable. They are produced to be consumed, right? Either in the mines, in the cane fields, well, where they also often die, or in other ways. And this is really fascinating to me on a number of levels. I think we're going to see in a minute, there's little outcry about it. One identity group is murdered 10 times more than another one. Have you guys been hearing about this stuff? Nobody. All of these things I talk about, the men's shifts in men's identities, it's not so different in Europe and other parts of the world, this education issue. How many people are pretty familiar with those trends? Okay, about 6. And there was about 80 of you very familiar with the women's trends. Why is that? All right, well, we'll go on. So here's the sum of some chains of trends that men are suffering in Latin America. All right, I have a theory, some theories about why it is. Gender theory grew first out of feminism, women's movement in the north, and then when we started looking at gender in the global south about 25 years ago, people were really into looking at poor, dark, barefoot women. A lot of things have changed in 25 years, but I'm very haunted by the continuity of this image. I mean, gender and environment, right? We have like a woman with some plants. Okay, I'm upset that it's only women, but I'm really upset that it's one woman. For me, the transformative power of class analysis, racial analysis, gender analysis, is in looking at the relations of power and the systems of power. Does that, anyone agree with that? Well, how could you look at one individual and understand power? And it's like, what am I going to empower her by giving her an injection of empowerment? Right? See, I also love this marching on towards progress. One woman marching from left to right towards development. Anyway, this public imaginary about what social difference and gender difference is about makes it really difficult for us to understand the production of these beasts and burdens, because we don't see it. If you ask, I often ask students, who suffers more violence, men or women? Oh, women. And if I look at the statistics, how can you not know? It's so natural for men, for poor men to suffer violence, that we don't even see it. It becomes part of the world. All right, so we got more women in nature, da da da. All right, I'm not mad at having like this little girl be seen as part of gender and energy. That's fine. I'm very happy to support attention to her. What I would like, and what I think would be politically more powerful, is to look at the dynamics amongst the different identities. What do you think? Gender and energy? Something else going on here? Does that show you a different, does that prompt you to think differently about identity intervals? Okay, very good. So some people now are studying men. That's great. These are superb books, by the way. It's not a, doesn't help me so much to see like a book about women, a book about men, a book about rich people, a book about poor people, as Eric was saying this morning, right? Or as Lawrence was saying, you know, we'll study the Indians and the black people apart and not the white people. I think we try to look at how they work in systems, which is one thing that I've been working at in some of my books, to look at environmental dynamics in relation to social systems of power and see how they interact. And now we're going to see in one case study some of the things that we can see happening. All right, this is a case, and it is in Chiloé, an archipelago in the south of Chile. Who's been there? Oh, look at that. Lots of people know Chile. I could talk about it. It was quite isolated geographically, socially, for much of history until about 25 years ago when there was a tremendous boom of salmon growing. There's always been a little bit of tourism, and the tourism is also growing a bit. It's got some UNESCO heritage stuff going on there. So what I'm going to look here is at how some of the social organization interacted with these entrepreneurial initiatives to transform the territory during this period in quite powerful ways. The method began. It was a group study that I was involved, a bunch of other people were involved with. It involved a 900 household survey that was done by Woods Institute for the Environment at Stanford. Another colleague worked a lot on the labor data and the wages, and I worked with a team of students that did, and students and colleagues, including a student from Lund University, that did interviews, focus groups, etc. So we'll share some of those. Okay. Before 1990, Chiloé men and women interacted with farms, forests, coast, mainly for subsistence, and they managed the coastal ecologies and the marine ecologies as commons. And it was all kinds of traditions about who harvested fish, seafood, feed, shellfish at different moments, when and where, and with which technologies. So that had gone on for a long time, the coastal and marine ecosystems. Throughout the 20th century, men migrated quite a bit. They went to mines in the north of Chile. A lot of them went to Andrea's country, to southern Argentina, where they worked shaving the sheep. There's another name for that, isn't there?
Shearing
the sheep, esquilador. Some of them went back to the islands at the end of each session, some didn't. The temporary end loss of men during that time was such that in the 1960 census, there was actually 30% more women than men living on the islands. And in men's absence, temporary, often for about 6 months, women did manage all the subsistence labor and the reproductive activities. Then came the boom. So in 1970, there was no Atlantic salmon. Who knows on what ocean Chiloé is? What's it called? Right, okay. These are Atlantic salmon. They weren't there by 2008. That is just 30 years later. 700,000 tons of salmon were being harvested every year. It's a miracle, isn't it? One of the nation's greatest exports. So the right of commercial operators to claim coastal waters was codified in the Chile's 1999 General Law on Fishing and Agriculture. And this sort of aggressive appropriation of the commons that took place, of the environmental commons, wasn't really resisted so much by people. And you're like, what the hell were they thinking? It's like, come and rape me. Well, there's some things going on that made it more complicated. During this period, everything happened that rural developers want to happen. It's like a dream come true. Instead of bleeding population, they gained people. Employment soared. Look at that, employment of women up 70%. Income up 25%. Poverty down 40%. I mean, this is like a dream. USAID is, yes, victory. This impoverished, isolated, backward rural place has come, right? So, you know, people were like, it's okay. So take away our commons, we can make it work. All right, one question people had. What facilitated such an impressive expansion of this industry? Amongst other factors, interviewees said, oh, it's the inherent qualities of Chiloé residents. You guys have been here, can you tell what was special about them? The women have like a discriminating eye and a natural patience that allows them to stand at the production, what it's called, like when the line goes by? At the production belt for hours, continually doing their job, and their naturally delicate fingers allow them to fillet the fish. And they were born to debone. Chiloé men, on the other hand, are naturally tough. Willingness to perform arduous and risky work is attributed to their inherently strong nature and their bold constitution. Right? They're tough. So. One thing that happens is treating these skills and values and knowledge as if they were natural justifies labeling the jobs as unqualified, and you can pay them less. That's fine. It also discredits the experience, the education, and actually the meaning that culture has built into these bodies that allows them to do a good job at their work. To say it's just natural, that's like treating them as if they're beasts, right? When in fact, there's all kinds of cultural stuff that allows men and women to be good at different jobs there. So we'll look at that. What I really want to ask, and what I want all of you to ask, is what happens when we recognize that diversely socialized and culturalized humans are valuable resources, that this knowledge and ability and values and meaning that goes with it are actually quite valuable resources, and that those resources can be appropriated for capital, for, you know, capital accumulation. But they can also, and they always have been used for collaborative organization of production and reproduction of life ways, for resilience, sustainability, richness of life. They work both ways, and so I'm trying to bring attention to those resources, right? So when we shift the explanation from biologically inherent traits to actually this kind of cultural process, we have a different narrative. In a territory with virtually no industrial history, neither men nor women had any experience with these tasks, right? But the managers came in and they very quickly created a gender geography. And they're like, okay, men, you go over here. I mean, the survey of 900 houses saw that only one person in the whole territory practically knew how to scuba dive before 1990. But now it's like, oh, you have a penis? All right, put on this scuba outfit and go there because men are better at scuba diving and picking the dead fish out of the nets, right? Oh, you're a woman? Oh, let me see your delicate hands. You go stand at the same time. So we got this kind of like organization that drew on some kind of expectations of gender difference, but created a whole new geography of gender. And the fascinating thing is it's very quickly naturalized. Oh yeah, I was born to, you know, swim around in a thing, whatever. So, this is what happened. By 2009, 40% of salmon workers were women. Almost all of them worked in these factories. Right? There were some men that worked there, and mainly they did very certain jobs, like scooping the guts out of fish. That's one of the first things. And also carrying big, heavy things around, like especially inside freezers. That's what men got to do in the factory. And at the fish farms, it was almost all men. In the beginning, more women were there because they fed the fish. You know, women are naturally nurturing. We nurse babies, so we can feed the fish. But then that became mechanized, so they sent those women over to the factory. All right, men, accustomed to cold, dirty, dangerous migrant work, Chiloé men were prepared for somewhat similar conditions. They were, I think, cultural meanings of what it meant to be a man encouraged them to embrace, or at least endure, dangerous and painful daily work. Because it somehow it made them feel manly. Does that sound possible to you guys? All right. Yeah, just saying it. I'm like a little confused just saying that. All right. Chiloé women. This is interesting because they were also accustomed to long hours of physical labor. They used resources all around the territory. They moved through in the seaside, in the farms, in different places, and they were used to not getting paid. So in some ways, according to local norms, doing productive work outside the home and getting paid less than men all had been considered as very proper woman-like things to do. And it's interesting because in this place, there was very little of this kind of resistance against women going out to work. But you see, I know many of you probably read over the last, during the same time period in Guatemala, in Mexico, in Juarez, on the border of US and Mexico, hundreds, perhaps thousands of women have been tortured and killed in this moment of a generation of women starting to go to work from their farm, right? This kind of, there was a lot of sort of fear and upsetness about this. It didn't happen in Chiloé. And so in a way, what I'm saying is this industry took advantage and enjoyed a certain type of gender arrangement that allowed them to quite easily put women into the work all day and not have a lot of gender reaction, not a cultural reaction against that. All right, in sum, Chiloé patterns of identity together with naturalization of the same worked with other factors to constitute the cheap and willing labor that was necessary for the industry to make a profit by exploiting Chile's natural resources. Without these humans, I don't think they could have made a profit. They can't just go with their machines and vacuum up the fish, right? They need all of these people. In turn, the industry also changed ways of life. It changed the environment and it changed people. I'm just going to mention one thing. A lot of stuff happened, but I just mentioned a couple. Men, they were assigned to riskier jobs, and in the beginning there was actually quite a lot of accidents and things. I think that's gotten better as the companies get institutionalized. But in any terms, working at a regular job in your home territory, I think it keeps you alive more than these odysseys that they did before in buses and trucks and working in mines all over the place. So first of all, they could exercise political agency because they're alive. Secondly, they're in their home territory all year round. So that gives them also a new space to move and to be and to do something about making that territory. A fascinating and I think very fruitful avenue that's arisen, which I really I would love to pay attention to because I think it gives us hope, is that a significant rise has happened in participation in what's called cultural organizations. In fact, the survey, which asked about every question, they said, how was it before 1990 and how is it now, right before the salmon and after, found over 100% increase in membership in cultural organizations, which are like folkloric organizations, historic organizations, etc. And the interesting thing is it used to be almost only women, a few women participated, and now it's majority men. So these men are taking it and they're putting, they become very environmental. Their organizations, they work with myths and histories about mermaids and sea creatures, and they're redoing these special feasts and special stories. And a lot of it has to do with the cultural tradition of human environmental relationships. And I think it's absolutely fascinating and motivating to see these people, these men who had been migrants for 100 years, now sort of getting an opportunity back in their own place and being involved in these organizations. And these organizations have also become a point of counterattack against the industry, as you'll see in a moment. All right, so there's a lot of changes going on. I'm not going to talk to you about all of them. One of the interesting things is that for the first time in history that we know of in Chile, there became a big difference between different groups of men. Our data on incomes shows that working men and women, these people, both earned right about minimum wage. Men earned a little bit more. But it turns out about 15% of the people earned like 50 times more. I mean, not like, actually 50, you know, huge amounts more. Does that sound like any countries you, anyone live in a country like that? Okay. There's a lot of countries where men are divided into different groups like that. And probably in many of your countries, in mine, you can even see them. And these people very easily recognize from blocks away who were the worker men and who were the engineers and the owners. Their clothes were different, the way they walk were different, their shoes were different, their cars are different. Is that like your? Like, they're not the same. They're different creatures. They get paid different levels, and that contributed to actually the Gini coefficient looking worse after 25 years. Even though poverty went down and income went up, inequality grew bigger, and it was largely between rich men and poor men. So you get these quite different groups of men. Another thing that happened is local men lost control of many of the processes of producing and reproducing their territory through their own practices, their practice of fishing, their practice of farming, of hoeing their own land, of all the stuff they did, partly because of these legal changes and partly just because of the power of these technical engineers and owners and whatever, the symbolic power of the expert man that came in, different type of being, right, that came in and took over. So we got these kind of fascinating things, and some theorists call this idea hegemonic masculinities, where it's not like all men dominate the earth and all men have power over women, but in fact, certain constructions of men dominate other men, whether it be, there's all kinds of history. All right, so I'm going to tell you one of the most powerful things, which Alf also writes about, which I mentioned before, how we naturalize these historical processes. I love this quote. This is a quote by a manager of a fish plant who explained to us in one breath how sexes are naturally different and I work really hard to separate them and make them different. Right? Okay. Specializing the sexes, helping to fortify, to reinforce the strength of women, which is keen eye, dexterity, and the mind. Right? And for the men, putting them in the rougher and tougher jobs where you can develop them a little more. So I think that we should continue with the sexes as they are. Is this beautiful? I mean, it's brilliant. It's hegemony at work, right? Here's this idea. I am actively producing a geographic space, a life space, and telling you that God made it or evolution made it, right? Even as you see me do it before your eyes. It's brilliant. Anyway, that's the tricks of history. All right, from an industrialist point of view, you might say Chile gender system and salmon production is a marriage made in heaven. Local residents gain access to more money, consumer goods, modern facilities, competitive advantages earned by this industry facilitated growth of business and profit. Production expanded at an astounding rate. See this blue, this glorious blue line shows the tons of salmon produced by year. Is that amazing? Really great. Interesting thing you have, the pink one is actually the number of firms. It's a common thing in sort of new capitalist initiatives. A lot of people try out to make it, and a few companies end up being stronger for letting it go. But anyway, soaring success. Some of you might say, oh, what happened at 2009? Did anyone notice something weird at the end of the graph? Okay, well, so production, I told you, expanded at an astounding rate. Anyone here concerned about reproduction? Production in itself, good enough? No, I don't see no proponents of reproduction. Okay, after our early discussion of domestic labor, you won't be surprised to find that people in the survey said, wow, thousands of women are now in the factories all day. We're having trouble organizing and getting done the work necessary to sustain our homes. We're fighting about it, there's whatever, there's trouble. You also won't be surprised that those 700,000 tons of Atlantic salmon led to a complete ecological collapse. All right. Outbreak of infectious salmon anemia decimated the fish population starting, yeah, it really, I think the first appearance was 2008, and by 2010 it was decimated. 22,000 residents were put out of work in that 1 year. And the interesting thing is the epidemic unleashed a whole range of environmental concerns. It could be like Marco's story. You know, people were talking, but we didn't hear them before. And now there was sort of an opportunity for those voices to get heard more. Because, oh my God, all of our fish died. Oh, is there a reason to listen? What were they concerned about? There's a huge amount of waste. I mean, can you imagine the poop from these 700,000 tons of salmon? And there's pharmaceuticals that they use, antibiotics, and people say, well, what about our community? We live on all the different seafood in that water, and you're dumping all these antibiotics into the fish. This might hurt us. There might be resistant bacteria and things growing. Researchers noted 50% loss of marine species diversity in that region versus other islands nearby. Residents said that the color and flavor of their own fish was changed because of what was going on here. Also, this whole process killed native predators, which were sea lions, which was one thing that people like me and you probably go, we like to go to Chiloé on holiday and take pictures of sea lions, and that was a nice little piece of it. So anyway, I'm really interested in this sort of moment where the discourse changed. And I'm sorry that it takes an ugly crisis that hurt people. I think often in our lifetime we've also seen that, haven't we? We're saying, warning something, just like, I'm sorry, I forgot the name of that journalist. Rose?
Tina.
Tina, saying something and nobody's really paying attention, and then a dam breaks or hundreds of thousands of fish die, and then all of a sudden we start maybe having space, which is a moment that we can take advantage of also, or think positive turn. Another interesting thing is that this ecological crisis brought attention to other challenges to sustainability. Job insecurity, loss of local traditions, loss of cultural identity, restriction to access to people's own territory. People started talking about that and saying quite explicitly, oh, this biodiversity conservation in nature has something to do with my well-being and my meaning in life and my social reality. Does anyone here believe that? Nobody?
Yeah.
Biodiversity? People are saying it, you know. Farmers, fishermen, local people are saying, well, wait a minute, that marine system ecology has something to do with the stories my grandpa told me and the value and the pleasure of eating this special food together and putting these things together in ways that are, I think, amazingly powerful, that they probably already were doing, but I wasn't paying attention to it. I didn't have the opportunity to pay attention. I think other people did. All right. Now, to sum up, what changes do we see in the relations of power that govern production and sustainability of human, cultural, and natural resources, right? So we got human bodies, we got fish and oceans and whatever, natural resources, and then we got these kind of cultural resources, which are knowledge and values and motivations that allow all these things to work together. All right, we saw a hierarchization of masculinities, and so that the manliness that used to have pretty much important power in producing and reproducing the territory was replaced by a very different type of manliness. And the first one was rendered sort of into beasts, right? Into hands. All right, we also saw new forms of collective power emerging amongst those people that were no longer controlling the way they were before. And I'm especially interested in the way that leadership in this realm of cultural organizations and folkloric organizations, it really distinguishes local men from those experts that are in their territory. It's something they have that the, you know, the whatever, the PhD, what do you call a pissy culture expert? There must be a name. The person that studies fish, what's it called? Yeah, anyway, the fishologist with a PhD from Lund University. So cool. But if your grandpa told you the stories about the fish that comes up at midnight on the All Saints Day and tells stories, right, you can glorify that, and that expert fish man can't. All right. So in a context with very few institutionalized avenues for citizen participation and political action in relation to the environment, this cultural organization became a way that people could motivate and get together about their environment, and also one that distinguished them from the power operating on different scales. These experts that had power connected to changing laws in national legislature, to international contracts, etc., they didn't have one type of power that these local people found, which was the power of tradition, of stories, of myths and images and food and eating together in special ways that made them solidary and made them feel connected to the environment. All right, so that was my conclusion, is what I want to say is I hope this work contributes to efforts by all of you to look critically at the way human, cultural, natural resources are being exploited, produced and exploited to make degradation, to make climate change, but also, and probably more important, to think creatively about ways that they are necessary and have always been worked together to make rich, sustainable life ways for people in all kinds of contexts. So that's your challenge.
Okay, we have time for questions. Susan, do you want to take several questions at a time?
Sure, yeah. And they don't have to be questions. I prefer people just tell your own story.
So, 1, 2, 3. Yes.
Can I start?
Yes. Yes, you can.
Okay. Just because of the part of the text you had in your presentation, I remember a paragraph that I used to explain a point of view in an article I wrote. And I will just read this.
Yes, please.
And I will then ask you if you know who wrote this. So,
this isn't a PhD exam.
No. This is important because I think we will understand. We can conclude that male superiority in terms of size, strength, courage, and fighting and energy comparing to women has been acquired during primitive times and has been potentialized, principled by intermedium of conflicts between males for the possession of females. The superiority of male in intellectual capacities and creative capacities has been due natural selection, combining hereditary effects of habit, because men who are more talented have the ability to successively conquer more women and then sustain themselves, their women, and their descendants.
Mm-hmm.
Who wrote this?
Marvin Harris or Charles Darwin, or maybe it was Jesus.
No, it was Charles Darwin, and this has been one of the point of view that some new materialist feminists have been exploring,
mm-hmm.
like Joanne Rook Garden, when she writes about her point of view of bioevolutionary of biology, where she sees that gender is the first this Darwin was the first to create a universal gender theory based on evolution.
Sure.
And
well, okay.
So this has been, you know, like creating models relations that have been hyper masculinized and have been and creating a model of society that is heteronormative and violent.
Mm-hmm.
And so I really liked your work. I think the work that other families have been doing and in the studies of masculinity are very, very important. But we also should be very careful when. How do I say this without discriminating men?
Sorry.
The way you want to.
I'm afraid for that masculinity and the construction of masculinity will occupy the debate and the issues of women. I agree that yes, we should talk about discrimination inside men and class, and I think your presentation is a very intersectionalized. But from the point of view of activism and of changing and of transformation, I'm a little bit afraid that can take us from sometimes the real point.
Take it from what?
From the real points, like.
That is women in power.
How power relations are constructed with tension.
Yes. All right.
Okay. Yes.
My question is very similar, although far less theoretical. I feel like there, at least in the United States, there's this kind of this moment right now in popular culture where there's a lot of writing about how difficult kind of the current culture and economic circumstances are for men, and particularly blue-collar men. And I'm not at all equating your research with this, but I was wondering how.
Thank you.
I feel like it's much more nuanced and complex than that, but I was wondering how you prevent kind of the stuff that you're talking about from being appropriated and having sort of the class elements cut out and used in this way, or I guess you could also say how you keep the focus on kind of the systemic or the corporate forces that are creating this gender binary versus an idea that there's some sort of distributive narrative where women gaining power is taking power from men.
The zero-sum game.
Yeah.
Yes, what's your name?
Katie.
Katie, very good. And I'm sorry.
Irina.
Irina, that's right.
Okay.
No, my question is somehow the same, but I want to ask something concerning the methodological approach.
Yes.
On going to the field and having in mind the gender question. I try to say that since you want to hear a story, that in my case studies, that I'm studying an environmental conflict in Greece at the moment. What I find very interesting is that women are, for me as a researcher, not the more willing, are the only at the moment that I can speak with. And I haven't, till now, managed to find a way to explain it. They are very active in the conflict. Mm-hmm. They are very active. At the same time, men are being also a member of the organization, but they are not willing to discuss about this conflict as something of their everyday life. Mm-hmm. Something like it's more complicated. It's a stupid question, but I want to see the methodological approach on such cases.
What's your name?
Yoros.
Yoros? And where are you? In Greece?
Yeah.
Okay. That's
superb questions. All right, first of all, let me tell Yoros. Whenever we do research, different people tell us different stories. And I would say methodologically, the key thing is to talk to everyone we can. I love that Marco was trying to see like an engineer, see like an investor, see like a townsperson. I wasn't so happy that you called some of them the bad guys.
The bad guy.
Yeah, I know you're doing it as a joke. But we don't need to go in and say these are the good guys, these are the bad guys. Right? Men are the bad guys, women are the good guys, whatever. Right? But try to hear from everybody And we don't know ahead of time what social axes of differentiation are going to be relevant in any environmental conflict, in any type of issue we're studying. Is it going to be class? Is it going to be spatial location? Is it going to be religion, ethnicity? But if you listen to everybody and you're open enough to pay attention and actually, you know, scientifically keep track of who's who and who's telling what, then as the story emerges, or even 50 years later as someone's understanding it, you'll be able to see those patterns. Right? Do other people see that also, that you can't, when you're right there, we can't always see the patterns. But in methods training, what we can do is note everything down and make sure we're paying attention, including to people's identity, not just to the content they have to say about the environment. All right, the other, those are very common responses. A lot of feminists say, like, you can't study men. Susan, I don't want you using your intellectual resources studying men. Men are bad. Women have so much more problems, they need so much more attention. Okay, I work in ecology. Like, ecosystems, all the pieces interact, is that right? I can't just look at the fish, I have to look at the sea lion and the tree that's leaching out of the water and all these things. And I, like, it doesn't make sense to me scientifically to study one piece without seeing how the habitat works together. So scientifically for me, I don't have any doubt. I think that's the way I want to study. I study systems. I study ecosystems, I study class systems. I don't want to study poor people and their problems. I want to study the economic, socioeconomic system and see how it produces poor people and produces problems. I understand that there's women movements and feminists that don't like that, and I respect them, and I understand. And I think part of it is this idea, there's two key things going on there. One is looking, categorizing the whole world by their penis and their vagina, men and women. I mean, it's such a funny thing, and to see feminists doing that, I mean, I'm a feminist, I'm part of that group, but to see us sort of doing that when all of our intellectual energy is actually about being against that, saying, oh, we're not determined by our organs, we can be whatever, we can create all this stuff, but then turn around and say, men are this, women are that. It seems like a curious contradiction in our thinking. The zero-sum game comes out of it, right? Taking from one, have to take from the other, which I think you see from my case is totally not really applicable, right? In an ecosystem, you don't look at that. Oh, the fish are doing better. That, therefore, the tree is suffering. No, I mean, it's part of the system. All right, the most important thing I have to say about that is political. This meeting is about politics. I think when we only make gender about women, like all those pictures you saw, those books you saw, it has a couple of responses. First of all, it doesn't motivate men to think that gender change is in their interest. In fact, it motivates many men to think gender change is going to hurt them and resist. This statistics I showed you, does anyone here think maybe some gender changes might be good for some men in Latin America? Raise your hand if you think there's any man in Latin America that might actually live longer or have a more safe or fulfilling life if there was some right. So I think in some way, scientifically, looking at everybody makes sense to me. And politically, I think talking and thinking in a way that allows all actors to feel and believe that they, each one, he, she, it, can benefit from changing and creating and recreating a new social nature is really powerful politically. We don't want to divide and conquer, so only the Indians and not the white, or only the poor and not the women are working together for transforming the world. You know, all the pieces have to be there. So I also don't have a question on that front, but I do respect people that are feeling it's going to take attention away from women and need attention. You know, I'll listen.
Sorry, I just think like studying as a system, studying, as you said, you study a system. But for me, one thing are power relations, and another are ecological relations. Of course, ecological relations are always power relations.
Right. Isn't that what our meeting is about?
No, but the thing is like one thing is like the in ecological relations. Of course, we always have. Gains and losses, you know, like that we have, like in ecology, we have like 9 typifying kinds of relations that happen. But when we look at gender, we cannot use those categories to look at the difference between genders.
you know, we cannot pick the categories of ecological relations. We cannot look at use them to try to understand the power relations between gender, between power gender and class, between gender and race or class and race. You know, I think for me it's a little bit too confusing. You know, like, and somehow it despolitizes. It takes the political dimension of the problem. No.
Okay.
Maybe someone can help me understand.
That one, Lawrence and Marco. Sorry, the next.
Okay, I am Lucia from
Ecuador.
I am a little bit confused about the statistics that you showed at the beginning of the presentation.
And can you make yourself known as well?
I'm from Ecuador. Yeah. I'm so confused about the statistics that you showed at the beginning. Because I'm asking of women are you talking about? And you show the statistics about Latin America.
Yeah.
I am interested to know if you have it's so difficult to think about this data without thinking about the race, for example, race and gender division.
Absolutely, yeah.
Especially in Latin American countries, where, and especially in the Andean race, for example. So when you talk about Latin America, without making this kind of difference,
yeah, absolutely, okay.
There's a gap there.
Yeah.
And if you have data or you have to think about that, I think the political consequences of these are really important. I will talk about Ecuador, for example, that is a very, we have a high biodiversity and high culture diversity. And you are talking about how the social reproduction system works. The role of the indigenous women, for example, and the changing of these worlds affects not only them, but also the community and the role of the children in the community and the role of the men. Mm-hmm. So it's so difficult to me to be to understand why you present this data with this purpose, because I think there are many gaps there. Especially if you are trying to related with the ecological conflict. I think it's important to take this into account. And also, another category in Latin America that is really, really important is the class relationship. Because this improvement in the access to jobs or whatever will have a different impact if we are talking about middle class, high class, or poorest.
Mm. But, so, to me, who is the woman that you are interviewing for? I think she asked and made a statement that covers what I wanted to ask.
Marco, yes, from Stockholm. So, no, I have a question or maybe a comment about the construction of the body, in a way. Because in your presentation, which, by the way, I liked very much, it was very clear, at least according to me, that it's a social and cultural construction. Huh? You have the strong men going down, and then you have the women with the delicate hands working and so on. And so this is very clear. But I was also wondering about the ways in which social inequalities are actually embodied into the body.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not just
yes.
a narrative about, you know, how the body is and works, but actually it's embodied into the body of the people in terms of illness, in terms of exposition to some kind of job-related, you know, disease, risk, and so on. And I think that there has been some research lately about epigenetics and the way in which the body in the African American community, for instance, is actually structured around the category of, you know, class. So there is something there. And so I was wondering, how do you deal with this, on one hand, this social construction of the body, but on the other hand, then the I would say, the materiality of the construction of the body.
Okay. First of all, thank you, Lucia. If I had 2 hours to the presentation, I would have loved to talk about all of that. And I'm so glad that you brought it up there. Okay. I was, you know, I didn't take time to explain all of these. I did mention I'm working on different scales. I'm looking at the total populations because I'm trying to identify some national trends and some regional trends, and then looking at case studies where things like spatial identity, ethno, class, racial are coming in. Almost all of these data are from CEPOL, which is like the EU or something like that, a statistical unit that covers all Latin America. And these are based actually on census and household surveys. So they're not race, class, or gender specific. On the contrary, they are, the household surveys are a representational sample, and census are every single household. Right? So actually, when you look at these life histories, it's every single person. And that doesn't break down automatically into space, race, class, etc. There was just one case where I did to try to make the point, actually I went to rural and urban, but I tried to make the point that this educational thing is different. And I would have taken the time, and the reason I actually chose this to take the time, but in my rush I didn't. All right, I find it surprising that across these are different income quintiles, that the education thing looks the same across them. There's a lot of other stuff where across class and gender things are really different, like Lucia says. Here, you'll see indigenous and non-indigenous is quite different. In the indigenous identified area, this is actually all of Latin America. There was, based on household surveys of every of the nations, right? Indigeneity and race cross at every moment. It's very difficult to deal with that in any type of comparative quantitative form, because those aren't labels that we can discreetly put on people in quantity. You know, they're so sort of non-comparable and flexible and alive that it's quite problematic on the level. But it is dealing with here, and just because I had already so many elements at play, I'm looking at spatial identity, socioeconomic, and gender crossing in this one case. I wasn't emphasizing racial ethnic identity here, but it's certainly at play in every moment, in every gender debate. So that's. Do you want to see other of the data? I mean, right. And so it's national. You guys know what census, right? So it's just. Right. Wait a minute. I want to get back to the body. All right. I had some pictures. You saw pictures of the body. Oh, I have it in the room. Oh, I'm sorry. All right. Let's look at these bodies. A colleague of mine, Clarence Gravely, studies race and health in the United States. And they looked at epidemiological data, massive numerous numbers, very millions of numbers that came from hospitals in the American Medical Association data bank, and found out that, what we already knew, that African American identified people have much higher rate of diabetes, asthma, heart disease. It turned out that doctors for years had been saying, oh, that's because they're from Africa. They came from Africa with those genes that inherently make them sicker. Well, these anthropologists studied it, and it turns out that people in Africa don't have those kind of epidemiological profiles. And it turns out that African immigrants that come to the United States don't have heart disease or asthma or anything more than white people the first few years they're there. What do you think happens after 20 years? Yeah, they start getting it. And so it's about how our bodies internalize the environment. It's, I mean, it's a beautiful question about body. We're very porous creatures in every way. And it's not only what we eat, the burdens we bear, the work we do, the illnesses and the joys that we experience all shape our physical body, and they shape the way our body moves around the world. And I think that kind of materiality of the results is amazing. I mean, it's a really important thing to look at. And the process of how it happens. You know, what is the machine that produces different bodies? Or what are the machines, the mechanisms that produce bodies with different experiences, different pleasures, different healths, different strengths?
Good. I have next on the list Philippe, Osatori, and Massimo. That's you're next. And then we're going to do one more round after that, and then there's two women. Okay, because now it's a fourth.
Well, you almost answered, but I was interested on your work related to ethnoclasses. I mean, because you talked about the gender classes and the problem of identities in the essentialized thing. Actually, is when you see the pictures there, and well, in Brazil, we know that these are all mostly poor people from the northeast. Mostly, they have some descendants from either Indians or slavery. And some of them use the identity for gang rights and land rights, maybe. Mm-hmm. So how are we working with this ethnoclass land rights without getting to a sense of this identity?
Oh, great. Okay. Okay. Excellent. Question. I can't wait.
Okay, I was particularly hit in your presentation by a thing that you mentioned about the creation in that island in Chile,
yeah,
of a cultural center and initiatives,
right,
that are also having sort of influence and,
yeah,
conditioning the
multiple centers, multiple cultures.
Yeah, yeah, and influence kind of also the political mobilization.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And I'm really interested in this because in the case I'm observing in Campania, I see that now the conflict is there, because there has been a conflict against the waste and contamination, but now is evolving also through the creation of a lot of cultural initiatives that are not immediately connected to the contamination and to the waste, but more on the building of a common identity that is inherently anti-capitalist, or at least wants to be, in the sense that try to see in the past and in the tradition also an alternative.
Mm-hmm.
To those model that is perceived as conquering, dispossessing, contaminating.
Mm-hmm.
But now, and this comes here comes the question, I would like to know more from you how rescuing and reinventing also, because I imagine also this taking back some cultural traditional forms is also reinventing them in the present.
Sure, sure, sure.
How this, in the case you observed, works to implement the possibility of political actions or openings?
Mm-hmm.
No. And the second question, isn't there, and I'm asking if you observed this in your case, also a risk of essentializing the cultural heritage in a way that then it becomes not politically progressive, but disempowering also, because creates differences, so we stuck in our identity, very local, built on our own tradition. Thanks.
Yes, I just have a few questions to fill some gaps in your excellent presentation, which actually I feel from my side very courageous, as you issue. One of the issue is linked to what Salvatore says is, okay, there is a depletion, the economy is on the ground, the economy which has been built out of this highly intensive salmon fishing. Mm-hmm. What are now the avenues for livelihood, for reclaiming livelihood?
Right.
What is happening? What is the role of the commons now?
Mm.
Or what are the possible avenues for that? The other one, well, this is just a brief comment. Your description of the gender characterization of course, the masculine character, very strong, blah, blah, and the female with attentive and very skillful in choosing. It reminds me of a very kind of early 90s or late 80s even, comments by the Economist about women factory workers in Asia, about these women essentially who actually had a working life of 5 years, because then in electronic factories, because their eyes, the eyesight was just lost after 5 years, about having very nimble fingers, yes, who were able to then work on electronic circuits. So this is a kind of an old story, really.
Sure.
But the thing that I, because you started your story here with the Beast of Burden and with his statistics that sees majority of women in the city as mostly single mothers in the city, and an increase in the rural of the male rural population.
That's what the statistics are showing.
Right.
Yeah.
So I was actually expecting you were telling us the story of these men in the rural population, but your story actually is a community which is divided in terms of labor, but I understand they are within the same area. They go back home in the evening, or not?
Right. The men in this, I showed you those two pictures of the sheep shearers. One was from 1940, and one was from 1990-something.
No, I'm talking about the
Yeah. So you're right, there's two different stories.
Yeah.
One is a story of these men that go away and subject themselves to painful, dangerous, exploitative work as migrant labor, and then come back to their isolated place and go away and come back. And the other is a story of something that happened historically that convinced many of them to stay for a while.
Okay. I see.
And then how they reinvented themselves in this new moment, this new time space. So they're two, you're right, they're two different stories that come together.
But what is the relation between the Beast of Burden and the story you started from, and this particular story you have actually described and studied more intensively, and also we don't have a sense of what are the hours of work. You talked about the wages, but I'm kind of concerned about, you just mentioned, what about reproduction? What happens about reproduction? They both work. What's the story of children? What is the story of the reproduction life?
Yeah.
And even the relation between the sexes in reproduction. So what is happening there on that side of life?
Oh, great questions. Okay. So Felipe started out, he talked about people, some of these places, many of the workers come from Northeast Brazil. And he described five indicators. He said they were poor class identity from Northeast Brazil, spatial identity, men, gender identity, with ethno-heritage of indigenous or Afro. Did you say all that?
Yeah.
Right. So these beasts of burden, some of them gather those up. Great question about movements where people, it's in some way parallel to these initiatives in Chilaue, but there's amazing movements in Brazil where people are motivating those identities to gain control of territory and sovereignty over their own lives. And some of you actually have been in another talk where I talk about that, and it's actually fascinating. Remember, I don't know if those of you that were here, I showed photos of the people, the landless people that I work with in Brazil, and then some of a community that is now an indigenous community and one that is now a quilombo, an Afro-slave community, and they look exactly the same. I couldn't pick them on the street different. But part of what's happening is that Brazil's law made avenues for people to get access to territorial sovereignty, right? To have land of their own as a group or private, and there's three avenues. One is through the landless movement, where you can squat and get nut, whatever, through squatting, through sort of a class identity, and you get titling. And the other two are by showing that you represent an indigenous tradition or a quilombo, a tradition, which were these runaway slaves that made things. And the law is written in Brazil beautifully. It's not an essentialist law. It's not like the US where you have your blood quantum, where it says you have to prove you're 1/16th Indian in order to get rights to be in this reservation. No, it says you have to prove that you're showing, that you're carrying on the tradition of an indigenous community, or a quilombo. That's how the constitutional amendment is, and it's absolutely fascinating because it allows this anthropological sense of mixed poor people that have been for centuries tossed about. Some of them have now gained access to land in any of those three categories and are living. They're doing theater, they're singing songs, they're telling about themselves as one or the other. And that's one thing I study, I love studying it, is their different discourse and representation of who they are in relation to these options. Is it essentializing? There's people that say, oh man, that's a ripoff. Those people, they just say they're Indians to get land. And I'm like, dude, that was the whole way race was invented. We called them Indians so we could take land away from them. That's it. I mean, it's come full circle. There's nothing. That's all race and ethnicity are, really. You know, someone said, oh, is it about power relations or environment? You know, to me, there's no difference, right? They're all words together. So thank you for bringing that case up. All right, Salvatore. Oh, great questions about this cultural center. Building a common ID. Someone was talking about commons. Is a commons the water we share or the woods we share, or is it a common set of values, of technologies, of practice that allows us to produce that space as a woods or these cultural organizations? You mentioned traditional groups, anti-capitalist. I'm not sure there's so much I don't know yours. But one thing I think that's happening is that society is changing very, very quickly, and that's frightening for all of us. And it also is harmful and degrading in many ways. People are resistant to those frightening changes. And looking back to tradition is a way to find strength for a different way to move forward, right? And if you say, what's hurting us now is capitalism, we can say, oh, my grandfather's way, they share, they're doing the farm. That's anti-capitalism. But that may be one way of talking. But I think often cultural tradition is a way of saying, what's happening right now is fast, it's scary, it's hurting, let's build a different way. And one of our resources is to go back and find our parents, our grandparents, the myths, the stories. Is that political? Salvatore says, can that be like a launching pad for the political? For me, yes, and it already is political. That's the politics of ontology. Because they're already producing themselves and producing their neighborhood and their yard as a different type of space and a different type of being. That's political. It's anti-capitalist, if you will, or anti, because just by producing themselves through singing songs together, eating foods together, whatever, they're doing something that, for me, is political. Many people wouldn't say it, but that's the way I see it. All right. Massimo has some of the similar questions. Also, this everyone here asks about essentializing, which I think is fascinating. It's a constant fear because our dominant discourse are essential. And I don't know if any of you here go on online dating sites, but like the first thing they say is essentialize yourself across 10 distinctions. Am I white, gay, heterosexual, black, you know, like am again. It's not do I do that, it's what I am. Right? Putting yourself in these categories. So all these realms of life, we're always essentializing ourselves on the census that we take and fill out. And it's really a tricky thing. Are we essentializing ourselves to say, oh, our community is indigenous. Hey, government, can we have control of this land because we're indigenous? It's a complicated process, and All right. Economy on the ground, Maximo, those, Massimo, those are tough questions. What's going to happen? Here are these people. They've been sort of drawn into this new mode of production, which has then collapsed. Anyone heard of that happening anywhere else in the world? First of all, it sucked up all of the value of their environment and their bodies, and then it's collapsed. And it's no problem. If I'm an investor, I just go somewhere else with my profits. I don't have a problem. But for these people, I can't answer those questions of what's going to happen, and I think those are very good questions. What I do want to talk about, the two different beasts of urban stories, I think it's quite important. I don't quite understand how they link together, but I think there's some things going on there. The people that are used in the most dangerous occupations in the world are mining, logging, and commercial fishing. Is that surprising anyone? The people that are used in these often come from sectors of society who have already been produced in a certain way. Their bodies, their education, their minds have been produced in a separate way that's probably different from the way we've been produced, right, you guys? I mean, I need to. What happens in the process is complicated. I don't want to get too long on this. All right, how do they weave together? Some people end up doing this for their whole lives and then they die. Some people, it's sort of a rite of passage. They grew up in a poor home and they say, okay, I'm going to go off and make it and then I'll come back with money and marry somebody and settle down, right? And as you can guess, some do make it back and some don't make it back because they're dead, because they're maimed, or because they're in the middle of the Amazon and they don't have enough money to get back and they are embarrassed to come back without anything because a man doesn't come back empty-handed and broken, right? That's he's supposed to come back victorious. And so all of these different processes, so it's a much more complicated realm than I presented here. I mean, I just mentioned, okay, yeah, there's these pieces of burden. It's a life cycle thing. It's about spatial, racial, class, identity. But in this Chilaway case, it's quite fascinating because it's something that's gone on for a whole century in a way that even though they clearly lost men, the census showed us that it was sort of a, what do you call it? A sieve, you know? Like the men went out, some came back. The men went out, some came back. It was part of a home system that managed to maintain. What I'm interested in is looking at the cultural resources available to these men. I haven't studied yet what it's like in these places. I would like to go live in one of these mines and see how people make common good and meaning amongst themselves. I don't know how it happens. But I do see that it, interesting thing that happened to these men at the end that came back to Chilaway and stayed there all year round, they sort of became beasts of burden in a local place, right? I mean, they're doing really hard, painful, cold, dirty work, but they're in their own home. And that, in a way, having their kinship relationship, their family, their children, their grandma, their own culture, give them a certain type of power to act in a certain way that I'm interested in. That might be different from what some of these men experience that are maybe living their whole lives trapped in these kind of spaces, rather than going back. And I guess it's about thinking, imagining new ways to create commons. We depend on the old family, but the, you know, that kind of like, okay, the kinship network is going to do it, but I think in this world, we need to find different ways. And so that's one thing I'm looking at to try to make to try to find sustainable futures for people that have been, that are in these machines that way. So those are all tough questions.
Are you prepared for one more question?
I'm
based us? Okay, two. That's
fine.
Thanks, Susan, for the presentation. I was thinking about your this narrative about Chile women and men on their natural qualities.
Yeah.
But what struck me was basically, because it reminded me of very colonial narratives of indigenous populations, you know, and on this essentializing part, in particular these populations of Americans, of the Americas. And I was thinking, but at the same time, you know, there's stacks of literature about, you know, the social construction of race and gender and how this has contributed to exploitation, capital accumulation, etc.
Yeah.
This makes me think, I mean, what goes wrong there? I know we cannot answer this question, but I'm thinking, is there something we're doing wrong also as academics in order to, you know, keep this, this message, make this message clear? And perhaps you can try to answer that in relation to your case study, you know, to your cases. And the second question is a bit factual. I was wondering about this issue that you said there is more than 100% increase in men's participation.